After the internal structure of monocot root and dicot root, now in this lecture we are dealing with the internal structure of the dicot stem. So in the previous lecture we studied the various internal structures from outside towards inner side of the TS of monocot and dicot root. It consists of epiblema, cortex, endodermis, pericycle and steel. So steel comprises vascular bundles, xylem, phloem and the central located parenchymatous pith. Now in this lecture we are going to study the internal structure of dicot and monocot stem. So first we are going to study the dicot stem, that is the internal structure of dicot stem. In transverse section, that is TS, the dicot stem shows the following distinct region, which are broadly described as epidermis, cortex and steel. So epidermis, as you know, it is the outermost protective covering of the stem. It is single layered. Outer wall of the epidermis is cutinized. The cells are compactly arranged and contain stomata and various kinds of trichomes. So as usual, epidermis, it is the outermost covering, protective covering of the stem. It is single layered. The cells are compactly arranged. The outer wall of the epidermis is cutinized. So it possesses the cuticle, a thick covering which meant for reduction of water loss from the stem. The cells of the epidermis are compactly arranged. They contain the stomata and various kinds of trichomes. Here we can see here the trichome. It is a multicellular trichome, multicellular unbranched trichome that we seen in the dicot stem. It keeps a check on excessive transpiration. It protects the plant from disease producing organisms and also protects from mechanical injury. So this is the function of the epidermis. It is mainly meant for protection to the inner layers of the epidermis. It protects the plant from disease producing organisms and also protects from the mechanical injury. Epidermis is meant to keep a check on excessive transpiration. So this is all about the epidermis. Next to the epidermis, it is the cortex. So this portion, it is made up of cortex. So it lies below the epidermis and above the pericycle. It consists of three distinct regions: hypodermis, general cortex and endodermis. So this is the cortex region of the dicot stem, which is mainly composed of hypodermis, general cortex and endodermis. So this portion we call it as a cortex. So one by one we are going to study the distinct regions of the cortex. The first one is the hypodermis. So hypodermis, it is 2 to 3 layered. Here we can see hypodermis, which is present below the epidermis. So the word hypo means below, the layer, dermis means a layer. So below layer, it is the hypodermis. So it is present below the epidermis, which is 2 to 3 layered. It lies below the epidermis. It is made up of cholenchymatous cell. So the function of the cholenchyma cell, it gives a mechanical support and strength to the stem. So hypodermis, which is made up of cholenchyma cells, the cells are living. This is the simple tissue. The cells are living in angular stem. It is confined to the corner only. These cells are thickened at the corner against the intercellular spaces. So this is the hypodermis, which is present below the epidermis. It is made up of cholenchyma cells. These cells are living cells in angular stem. It is confined to the corner only. These cells are thickened at the corner against the intercellular spaces. The chief function of the hypodermis is to give the mechanical strength to the stem. So this is the function of the cholenchyma. Hypodermis, it is made up of the cholenchyma cell. So the hypodermis gives a mechanical strength and support to the stem. So this is the first region of the cortex. Cortex consists of three distinct region. First one is the hypodermis, second one is the general cortex, and third one is the endodermis. So the first we seen, it is the hypodermis. Next to the hypodermis, it is general cortex. So this lies below the hypodermis and it is multilayered. So here we can see in this diagram, this is the cortex region which is multilayered, 4 to 8 layered. It is made up of thin walled parenchymatous cells. So these are the parenchyma cells and intercellular spaces are present. So these parenchyma cells are loosely arranged, so because of which these intercellular spaces we can see in the general cortex region of the stem. Some of the cells contain chloroplast, hence these parenchyma cells are called as chlorenchyma because it possesses the chloroplast. All cells are living cells. In addition, some of the cells contain resin and oil ducts. The latex bearing plants contain laticiferous cells in the cortex. The main function of the cortex is the storage of the food material. So the cortex, which is made up of parenchymatous cells where the stored food material has been found in the cortex region. In addition to this, some of the cells contain resins and oil ducts. The latex bearing plants contain laticiferous cells in the cortex, and the chief function of the cortex is the storage of the food material. Next to the general cortex, the sclerenchyma cells are found in the cortex of some stem. So some variations are also seen in some dicot stem. The cortex also consists of sclerenchyma cells. There are two types of sclerenchyma cells: short or irregular shaped cells known as the stone cells, that we also called as sclerites, and the sclerenchyma fibers. Sclerenchyma fibers are long, thick, elongated dead cells and serve as a strengthening material. Stone cells give stiffness to the cortex. So the sclerenchyma, which is made up of short irregular shaped cells, we also called it as sclerites, and a long elongated thick walled dead cells, we called it as fibers. So in some plants, this general cortex has been made up of sclerenchyma cells, and these cells gives a strength to the stem because the sclerenchyma fibers are long, thick walled dead cell and serve as strengthening material. Similarly, stone cells give stiffness to the cortex. Then the endodermis, this is the innermost layer of the cortex. Here we divide cortex into three distinct regions: hypodermis, general cortex and endodermis. So endodermis, it is the innermost layer of the cortex. These cells are, here we can see the endodermis, these cells are barrel shaped, compactly arranged with abundant starch grains. Hence endodermis is also called as a starch sheath. The endodermis consists of the abundant starch. So endodermis is also called as starch sheath. Sheath means covering. The cells are compactly arranged which surrounds the stem. So next to the endodermis, the portion occurs, it is the stem. So the endodermis cells are compactly arranged which surrounds the stem. The radial walls of the endodermal cells develop characteristic thickening of suberin called as Casparian strips. So the thickening pattern that is also seen on the endodermal cell, so that gives a characteristic Casparian strips which act as one of the character for the dicot stem. Then after endodermis, there is a stele. So stele is the central part of the dicot stem. The part of the stem next to the cortex is called as the stele. So this stele comprises pericycle, xylem, phloem. These are the vascular bundles and the central pith region. So the stele has been started in from pericycle and ends with the pith. So in dicot, it shows polyfascicular siphonostele or eustele. Eustele, it is a true stele. Poly means many, fascicular, vascular bundle. So many vascular bundles has been seen in the stele region of the dicot stem, and this stele region is well differentiated into again three regions: pericycle, vascular bundles and P3 region. Okay, so this is all about the steel. It is the central core of the dicot stem, which is present next to the cortex region. In dicots, the steel is polyfascicular. Fascicular means vascular. Poly means many. It is made up of many vascular bundles. The steel is siphonosteel or eusteel, and it is well differentiated into three regions: pericycle, vascular bundles, and pith. So the first we are going to study, that is the pericycle. So pericycle, it lies below the endodermis. It is generally composed of sclerenchyma and parenchyma cell. So the endodermis, which form a starch sheath around the steel, it is composed of sclerenchyma and parenchyma cell. The sclerenchyma may occur as a separate patches or as a continuous ring associated with the phloem of the vascular bundle and is known as hard bast. So here we can see the pericycle. The cells of the pericycles are sclerenchymatous and parenchymatous, and they may occur as a separate patches. Here we can see these patches above the vascular bundle, and it may associated with the phloem of the vascular bundle. So next to the pericycle in the vascular bundle, there occurs a phloem. So these patches of the pericycle that has been present above the phloem are known as hard bast. So it is also called as hard bast. It is made up of thick sclerenchyma cells. These cells are thick walled dead cells which serve as strengthening material. So it again give the mechanical strength or support to the stem. So this is the pericycle, where the cells of the pericycle, that is sclerenchyma and parenchyma, has been arranged in the form of a patches. The cells are thick walled dead cells. This is the mainly concerned with the sclerenchyma cell. It occurs above the phloem of the vascular bundle and is known as the hard bast. Then the vascular bundles in dicot stem, the vascular bundles are conjoint, collateral, and open type. Conjoint means both phloem and xylem. Here is the phloem, here is the xylem. Both xylem and phloem has been present in the same vascular bundle. Collateral, they are occur on same radius, and open means cambium is present. So the vascular bundles are arranged in the form of a ring. So here in this diagram we can see, this is the vascular, these are the vascular bundle. It is a polyfascicular siphonosteel or eusteel. Poly means many. So here we see the many vascular bundles which are arranged in a ring. So the specific arrangement of the vascular bundle has been seen in the dicot stem, which is the characteristic of the dicot plant. Here the vascular bundles are arranged in ring, and the steel is polyfascicular siphonosteel. Each vascular bundle is composed of phloem, cambium, and xylem. So here the vascular bundle consists of the vascular tissue such as phloem and xylem, and in between phloem and xylem there is a presence of a strip of cambium. So in this diagram we can see clearly, this is the phloem, this one is the xylem, and in between this there is a presence of a cambium, which is responsible for the secondary growth of the plant. Okay, so in dicot, the secondary growth occurs due to the presence of cambium present in the vascular bundle. So in dicots, vascular bundles are conjoint. Both xylem and phloem are present in the same vascular bundle. Collateral, they are arranged on the same radius, and open type means cambium strip is present in between xylem and phloem. And each vascular bundle is composed of phloem, cambium, and xylem. So one by one we are going to study all these things here in the vascular bundle. So the first one is the phloem. This lies externally and consists of sieve tubes, companion cells, and phloem parenchyma. Sieve tubes are larger elements than the companion cell. So the region in the vascular bundle where the phloem is present, this phloem consists of sieve tubes, companion cells, and phloem parenchyma. Sieve tubes are larger elements than the companion cell. Phloem parenchyma, which is a living, are smaller elements. All these elements are leaving. The chief function of the phloem is conduct the prepared food material from the leaves, and it has been transported to the storage organs and later from storage organ to the growing regions. So this is the main function of the phloem, conduction and translocation of the food material from source to the sink. So the phloem, which is made up of pseudotubes, companion cells and phloem parenchyma, all cells are living cells and perform the function of conduction and translocation of the food material. Next is the cambium. So the cambium is present in between xylem and phloem. So this is a strip of cambium we can see in this diagram, where it is present between xylem and phloem. Okay, so this is a band of a thin walled cells and it is a single to many layer. So here we can see the many layered cambium. These cells are arranged in a radial rows and are roughly rectangular in shape. If you see its shape, it is rectangular. They are arranged in a radial rows. It lies between the xylem and phloem, and cambium is responsible for the secondary growth and increase the thickness or girth of the stem. So the cambium, which is responsible for the formation of secondary xylem towards inner side and secondary phloem towards outer side. Okay, so this is referred as the secondary growth or the activity of the cambium. So as a result of the secondary growth or the activity of the cambium, it produces secondary xylem towards inner side and secondary phloem towards outer side. The overall result of this activity of the cambium is the increase in the thickness or diameter or girth of the stem. So secondary growth is responsible for increasing the thickness or girth of the stem. So this is possible because of the cambium. So in dicot there is a secondary growth because the presence of cambium strip or a cambium between xylem and phloem. Then the xylem, so it is formed before the activity of the cambium. So such xylem we call it as a primary xylem. So this is the first formed xylem is known as primary xylem. So we can see here in this diagram, the next to the cambium there is a presence of xylem that was produced by the cambium. So the first formed cambium, the first formed xylem is known as a primary xylem. The smaller elements of the xylem are known as protoxylem. These are the small diametered vessels. So the smaller elements of the xylem we call it as a protoxylem. The larger elements of the xylem are metaxylem. Larger, meta, smaller, proto. And if you see the arrangement of this protoxylem with respect to the metaxylem, the stem is endarched while the root is exarched, means protoxylem towards center and metaxylem towards periphery. Okay, so the smaller elements of the xylem are protoxylem while the larger elements of the xylem are metaxylem. The xylem consists of three different types of elements. These are trachytes, vessels and xylem sclerenchyma or wood fibers. Okay, trachytes are elongated thick walled cells and the diameter of the vessels is usually much greater than the trachytes. So these are long elongated tube like structures that we call it as a trachytes, while the vessels are shorter and having the larger diameter than the trachyte. The thickening of the vessels are annular, spiral, reticulate, pitted and scalary form that we also see in the types of the tissue. The wood fibers are long, slender and pointed. The elements of the xylem are lignified except xylem parenchyma. So the cells of the xylem are the dead cell except xylem parenchyma. The vessels are larger diameter cells which are short, while the trachytes are elongated, thick walled, long. To the contrary, the wood fibers or xylem parenchyma are long, slender and pointed, it having a fine diameter, and the other one element that is the xylem parenchyma, which is the living tissue. The all other elements like trachytes, vessels and the xylem fibers are lignified and all are dead. The chief function of the xylem is the conduction of water and minerals, but xylem parenchyma serves mainly for the storage of food material. The xylem is endarch. So what is endarch? Protoxylem towards center and metaxylem towards periphery. So this specific arrangement of the xylem element, it is referred as endarch. Protoxylem is located towards the center of the stem while metaxylem is present towards the periphery. So the xylem is endarch. Next is the pith. So the central core of the steel is known as the pith. Here in this diagram we can see this is the pith, which is a parenchymatous. The cells are loosely arranged, so intercellular spaces are present in between the cells. The cells are parenchymatous, means these cells are living cells having thin wall. The continuous pith radiate through the region between vascular bundle and form primary medullary rays or pith rays. The chief function of the pith is to store water and food material, for example stem of sunflower. So the function of the pith, it is the storage of the food material. So wherever the parenchyma cells occurs in the region of the stem, it perform the function of storage of food material. In addition to this, pith store the water because it is in close contact with the xylem element, which is mainly function for the conduction of water and minerals. So this is all about the internal structure of dicot stem. Now we are going for internal structure of the monocot stem. So here comparatively we are going to study dicot and monocot stem. So the TS of the monocot stem shows the following anatomical details, that is epidermis, cortex, hypodermis, ground tissue and vascular bundle. So again here we divide the internal structure of the monocot stem into three distinct regions: epidermis, cortex and vascular bundles. Okay, so first one we are going to study, it is epidermis. So epidermis, as usual, it is single layered with thick cuticle. Sometimes stomata may be seen. The cells are small, compactly arranged. The epidermal outgrowth, that is the hairs or trichomes, are absent on the monocot stem. The chief function is the protection. So this is the usual function of the epidermis. It provides the protection to the inner layers of the stem. It provides protection to the stem. The cells are small, compactly arranged, which having a thick cuticle. Epidermal outgrowth, that is the hairs, trichomes are absent. Next to the epidermis, it is the cortex. So it is differentiated into the hypodermis and ground tissue. In dicot stem, the cortex has been divided into hypodermis, general cortex and endodermis. Now here the cortex is differentiated into hypodermis and ground tissue. Okay, so hypodermis, it lies below the epidermis. So here we can see the hypodermis, which is lie just below the epidermis. It is made up of sclerenchyma cells. So if it is sclerenchyma, it gives mechanical support. It usually 2 to 3 layered and the cells are thick walled and compactly arranged. So the cells of the sclerenchyma are thick walled, they are compactly arranged, which gives mechanical support. Then ground tissue, it occurs below the hypodermis. So this region where we can see the ground tissue, it consists of thin walled parenchyma cells with intercellular spaces. Like dicot stem, it is not differentiated into the endodermis, pericycle and pith. It occupies a major portion of the stem along with the scattered and closed vascular bundle. So this ground tissue, which makes the maximum part of the dicot stem, where it is made up of the parenchyma cells. So this is the ground tissue that I am going to show it in this diagram by the arrow. Here these are the parenchyma cells, which are makes a major portion of the stem and which along with the scattered vascular bundles. So these are the vascular bundles which are scattered, while in case of dicot stem the vascular bundles are arranged in the form of a ring. But in monocot stem the vascular bundles are scattered and closed, means cambium is absent in between xylem and phloem. Okay, so this is about the ground tissue, which is made up of parenchyma cells. These ground tissue mainly serve for the storage of food material. Then the vascular bundle. In monocot stem, each vascular bundle consists of xylem and phloem. So we can say conjoint, both xylem and phloem are present in the same vascular bundle. Here we can see, here is the phloem, this is the xylem. Each vascular bundle consists of xylem and phloem, but cambium is absent. So we can say in case of monocot stem, the vascular bundles are conjoint, collateral and closed type. The xylem and phloem occur on the same radius. They are present in the same vascular bundle, conjoint, collateral and closed, means the cambium is absent. So vascular bundles are closed, do not have secondary growth. Comparatively, peripheral bundles are smaller than the central one. If you see the peripheral bundle, so these are the peripheral vascular bundle. This is the central one, vascular bundle. If you see the size of the peripheral vascular bundle, it is small, while the vascular bundle present towards the center are large. So comparatively, we can say that peripheral vascular bundles are smaller than the central ones. Each bundle is surrounded by the bundle sheet, that is the covering, which is present around the vascular bundle. The xylem is Y-shaped. So here this is the xylem, protoxylem and metaxylem. If we see its shape, it is Y-shaped. Okay, consist of metaxylem and protoxylem. The thickenings present are annular and spiral thickenings. Small trachytes are also found. Some of the protoxylem cells get degenerated and cavities form called lysogenous cavity or of water or water containing cavity. Phloem consists of sieve tubes, companion cell. The outer phloem is called protophloem and the inner phloem is called as metaphloem. Phloem parenchyma is altogether absent in monocotyledonous stems, for example maize stem. Here the arrangement of the xylem. Here the protoxylem is present towards the center of the vascular bundle, while metaxylem is present towards the periphery. So the enlarged condition has been seen in the monocot stem. So this is all about the monocot stem, where the pith region has been found to be absent. The vascular bundles are scattered. Those vascular bundles present towards the periphery are smaller and more in number, while the vascular bundles which are present towards the center are larger in size and they are less in number. So the crowding of the vascular bundle we can see in the peripheral region. So I said the vascular bundles towards periphery are more in number, and if we comparatively consider the size of the vascular bundle, vascular bundles towards periphery are smaller in size, while those towards center having larger vascular bundle, large size vascular bundle. The xylem in the vascular bundle is Y-shaped, consists of metaxylem and protoxylem. If you see the arrangement, this is the protoxylem, this one is a metaxylem, and in this vascular bundle, protoxylem is towards center and metaxylem is towards periphery. So the xylem is enlarged in the monocot stem. So in monocot and dicot root, the xylem is exarched, while in monocot stem and dicot stem, the xylem is enlarged. So this is the characteristic of the various internal structures that are present in the dicot and monocot stem. If you compare the internal structure of dicot and monocot stem, in dicot stem we see there are three distinct regions: epidermis, cortex and stele region. So epidermis, it is the outermost layer in both the cases. What are the differences between the monocot stem and dicot stem? In dicot stem, the vascular bundles are conjoined, collateral and open type, open for secondary growth. Cambium is present. In monocot stem, the vascular bundles are conjoined, collateral and closed type. In dicot stem, vascular bundles are arranged in the form of a ring, while in monocot stem, the vascular bundles are scattered. Peripheral vascular bundles are smaller in size than the central ones. They are more in number towards periphery than the center. The xylem is Y-shaped. In both dicot and monocot stem, the xylem is enlarged, means protoxylem is present towards the center, while metaxylem is present towards the periphery. So these are the differences between dicot and monocot stem. In the next lecture, we will study the internal structure of the dicot leaf and monocot leaf. Okay, so this is all for today. Thank you. Stay home, stay safe.